Did your mother have some kind of premonition about you were going to go into politics and become a lawyer? Because he was a lawyer. Right. He went into politics.
So actually, my name came from the fact my first name is Everett.
But that's your dad.
My dad did not have a middle name. He's Everett Tucker III. My grandfather did not have a middle name, Everett Tucker Jr. And so my parents just thought I needed, my granddad went by Everett. My dad goes by Rhett, short for Everett. And everybody thought I needed to have something different to go by. My grandmother, who you know, actually on the other side of the family, she likes to take credit for it. She jokes that she told my parents that if they didn't give me a middle name, then she was going to call me IV because that's the Roman numeral for four and Everett Tucker the fourth. So she takes credit for the fact that I got a middle name. But that's how Clark came about.
And it must have come from your family. Right. I mean, she picked it right out of your family.
Yeah, absolutely.
Your grandfather that I knew, Dr. Bost, he was from Fort Smith. And what type of a doctor was he? Was he a baby doctor?
He was the pediatrician. So he opened a pediatric practice in Fort Smith in 1952. And he was only the third pediatrician in Arkansas. He was the only one between Little Rock and Tulsa from east to west and Springfield to Shreveport north to south.
Hmm. So I guess he wasn't home very much.
Yeah, they made house visits in those days, as you know. And so my mom said they'd be having dinner, phone would ring, and my granddad would be out the door. You know, a couple things about his practice that I'm really proud of. One is when he opened his practice in 1952, he only had one waiting room. And not very many doctors only had one, if any, only had one waiting room at the time. They had segregated waiting rooms for people of different races.
Oh, I see what you mean.
And so he had a waiting room for everybody to wait together. And the fact that he did that and was right on the front end of it in the early 50s is something I'm very proud of. And he also always made sure that people got care. And my grandmother told me a story that one time he had her give blood to a patient that he knew would not be able to make any payment at all. And so that to me...
Your grandmother gave blood to a patient.
Yes, that my grandfather knew would not be able to pay.
Doctors don't do that anymore. Hey, honey, come down here, will you? I need a little blood transfusion.
Yeah.
So what is it about being a lawyer that, is that the part that appealed to you, was that you get to orate?
So everyone's supposed to have equal rights under the law. And it's really the same thing about being a lawyer that is public service and politics in general attracts me, because you can really make a very important difference in someone's life if you do it the right way. And, you know, Lady Justice is blind, and that's the way that it's supposed to be. Unfortunately, that's not always the way it is in reality, but we can make it that way if we do it one person at a time. And that's the way that I've tried to do it.
I don't know if Lady Justice is blind.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem like that to me. Somebody's got to defend the guy, even if he's guilty. So how do you call that blind?
Well, that's part of being blind, I think.
Oh.
Yeah. Everyone deserves due process. And I mean, that's what that means, I think.
It would be hard for me to be a lawyer and to know that my client was guilty and I still had to go to court and defend them.
So I haven't done a lot of criminal law. In fact, I've done almost none. So I understand that. Part of it, though, I think people need to understand in both civil law and criminal law is that, like, for example, if you have a client that's guilty, it's not that you always go to court and say that he's innocent. Sometimes it's, you know, negotiating a fair deal on behalf of your client with the prosecution to make sure that justice is administered fairly.
And now we're moving up to you deciding in 2014 to run for the Arkansas House of Representatives. Why? What happened? Did something happen?
Yeah, I had a few screws loose, I think.
But I think so, too.
Yeah.
I think that about all politicians, though.
Now, being a lawyer is a perfectly fine way to make a living, but I personally felt unfulfilled. I worked with great people, and by and large, I liked the people that I represented, but I still went home every day and felt like there was something missing, like there was something more that I could do for the community here. And so leading up to 2014, I was getting more and more involved with different community organizations here, but it still wasn't quite enough. And that seat opened up. My predecessor, John Edwards, had been term limited for his service in the Arkansas House. So it was an open seat, and I just decided to go for it.
What is the term limit?
At that point in time, it was 6 years in the House. It actually changed the day I was elected.
To what?
You can serve up to 16 years in the legislature in some combination between either the House or the Senate. But you could serve, if you serve 16 years in the House, you couldn't serve any in the Senate, but you could do it that way.
What is it about government that makes people like it so much? It's very complex.
It is very complex. And I don't know that all that many people like it that much.
My sister teaches government.
Yeah. Well, it's because you can have such a huge impact, I think, on people and our lives and our society.
If you like this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel by clicking on the picture of Carrie's face in the center of the screen. To watch the full-length interview, click the video in the top right. For more interview highlights, click the video in the bottom right. Thank you for watching.